I think most of you know me now as Tim Bancroft, the Antares studio coordinator, so I try and link things together. And things are slowly starting to come in that fashion. But what we're doing today is what we're running through today, is just firstly just saying what we're doing, why, and why we're actually saying this is a good time to work for Antares. But then at the end of it, because there should be a fair amount of time, it's a case of you asking what you'd like to know about writing, and that, if you like, is the sort of workshop moment in terms of what it would be useful for you to know if you want to write anything for Antares, and I know some of you actually do. So, is that okay?
Yeah.
But let's see if this works. Right. Why? So, we'll start with firstly, why. We're actually saying, you know, do write. We have actually sent something out in the emails saying, you know, just get in touch, do write if you want to. But the key thing what we're doing with Antares is that we've got this incredibly rich and very, very diverse universe. We're talking about something which has got 5.5 million worlds, all of which, you know, 2 million perhaps are vaguely the same because they're with the Concorde. 2 million are vaguely the same because they're with the Fall, perhaps. 2 million are vaguely the same with the Osorian. But to say 2 million is vaguely the same leaves a huge range of worlds. That's probably closer to 2 million, 1.5, 1.5, or so on. But however you look at it, it's still a huge diversity. And there's no way that one person can actually flesh that out. As you know, I started writing fiction and then got into helping with rule development, and then got into developing supplement, and some of the characters from my fiction were then pulled into, say, the Crisis Shard. Now, I was just the first. We'd love to be able to do that with loads of other people's characters, with loads of other people's forces or things or anything else. So it would be lovely to see in future supplements characters which more of the community have created, which have come into being either through good fiction, as I said at the end, or because of the scenarios they've written, through campaigns they've created. There's one, for example, releasing from the scenario. Do you remember? Does anyone remember the scenario competition that got run a while back? Yeah. Well, we're finally getting the ability to actually publish all of those now. The winning entry was by Merton, and that's Bronvar, and we've got a character in that who is Bracus Hayon, who we may actually end up creating a model for. So it's again that there's a fan created thing. We're actually publishing his campaign as a PDF. It's about this disgruntled guy called Captain Bracus Hayon on planet Bronvar. It would be lovely to be able to do loads more of that. So we're saying that the opportunity is there. And I'll come back to where the opportunity is shortly. Personal background, as some of you may know, I collect freeborn houses. And I publish them up on my blog. I want to transfer those onto the Nexus, which is something I'll talk about shortly. But that's going to be a new central repository for Antares. So it gives an opportunity for people to actually create their own freehold houses in this massive, incredibly rich universe. Personal force selectors, yeah, love to see those, especially with the background to it, saying how you use it, write about it, pictures of the forces you've got. Even straightforward things like tactical advice. You know, simple devices saying, this is how I use my freeborn really effectively. This is how I use my rebel guard to totally decimate everybody I ever come across, for example. Because if you have that sort of article, then somebody else will come up and say, no, this is how you beat rebels. This is. And that's what we're looking for. All of those sort of things can be absolutely fantastic. Themes, you've already seen some themed forces and photos of themed forces recently come up with a little bit of background in them. And we're looking for that sort of stuff. I know some of you have actually written bits and bobs for us, which have gone on to the newsletter, and we're also then transferring those on into the Nexus as well, which I'll come on to in a minute.
Now, do I hit spacebar?
No, it's obviously got a range, which is here, not 2 inches backwards that way. But the other thing is, even if you're not a very good writer, there's loads and loads of space. We'd love to see loads of modelling, painting and terrain articles, how-tos. You've already seen Wayne Clayton's wonderful articles on how to build a spaceship. And I love this spaceship. And we're loading that so we can actually all see it now quite easily rather than go through the articles side of the archive, of the New Testament archive. We've had John's recent set of articles which actually go into how to create an algorithm force and also at the same time create some terrain to go with his algorithm force. So that's a merge of theme and terrain at the same time. And a little bit of modelling and painting in there. So it's the flexibility of what we're looking for is incredible. Really, really fantastic. And of course, if you've got some wonderful models and you just don't think that you can write at all you have to do is just drop me a line and say, look, I've got these models, this is the general idea and thought about it, and then we can help with the writing and really put something together which looks fantastic, which people will really enjoy to read and look at the same time. Now, the Nexus is the next step in all of this. One of the things about Antares, and I'll come to this shortly, one of the things about Antares is where do you go for the history? Where do you go for the background? And really, you've got the main rule book, you've got the Crassus Shard, and you've got Zardos Horizon. And that's about it, really. There's a few bits and bobs on the Freeborn Shard and a few other places where Rick's gone over what some of the background is. And you've got some other bits and bobs related to it. So, for example, the Delta and the house which I created for the Freeborn is on my blog. In other words, scattered about all over the place. What we need to do is actually just pull it together into something coherent to say this is the stuff which has actually been spun off and been absorbed into the core universe. But actually, there's this whole load of other stuff which fans have created, which they want to share, and which you may find really exciting and really great. Spin off your own ideas, your own scenarios, your own stories, your own narratives. That's where the Nexus comes in. So, when we talk about articles and scenarios, what are we talking about? There are some guidelines already up on the website. If you go to the articles site, you can actually just look for Antares guidelines. There's a PDF which says this is what we're looking at, this is the format, and they've actually got on there a suggested format of what we need to think about when you write scenarios. The key thing is that we're looking for articles just interesting to gamers. We've got some incredibly rich, as I keep saying, science fiction, or space opera. I keep calling it hard space opera, and that's what I'd like to call it. And there's so much we could do in that, and there's so much which it sparks in imagination. So what we're looking at is four. It's articles which are interesting to gamers. In other words, interesting to you, the people who are writing it. It's sometimes easy to get all pent up in the detail and to go right into the 7th cousin, 13th removed of your favourite Albarine sergeant. Maybe that's going a bit too far, but there's an awful lot of interesting, perhaps nitty-gritty background which you could put about just a squad, for example, and just describe that squad. So the guidelines are there. The other thing, in general, if you want to send anything to us to review and just have for us to have a chat at, that's fine. Just send it to me. I'll put my email up here shortly, tim.bancroft@worldofgames.com. But if you're doing it, it's not that difficult. Just a basic font, 1.5 space, 11 point, basic writing, grammar, that sort of stuff. The more formatted and complex the formatting is, if you put it to PDF, everything else, the more difficult it is for us to process and adjust and pull up. So I've already said there's a template available for scenarios, but frankly, copy the format if you want for all the rules and supplements. That's it. I mean, it's really straightforward. You can just see the titles there and follow them through. I'll mention that. But if you've got any inquiries, if you want to discuss something, say, look, I've got this idea for something which I want to write about, or I've got this force and these rules which I'm using, which I'd like to just put up on the Nexus or something, send it to me and we can have a chat and have a look at it. So, where does it go? I've already hinted at some of this. So, firstly, most of the stuff which comes in will actually go through the newsletter. So you see articles first coming in. So the fiction, for example, you see first coming in. It will get published perhaps in serialised form in the newsletter, though there's some fiction which hasn't been. As you know, we've also got books. Dimensional Gates came out last weekend, I think, which is the second set of short stories based in the Antimatter universe. And after it's gone through the newsletter, normally we almost always put showcases up there as well, so that's figures to say, look at this painting, what this guy's done, which is great for ideas. I don't know if you've, how you regard showcases, but I look at them as a great source of ideas about how to paint stuff, how to actually put that stuff, everything else. From there it gets put into the web store. Well, it's not actually the web store, it's in the article archive side of the web store. And frankly, almost everything you've ever seen in the newsletter is still accessible in the article's website. Has ever anybody searched for anything in the article's website?
Tried.
Anyone else?
Tried.
There we go.
Okay. So the word is tried. I find it really difficult. All right. I find it really difficult to find things which I have written and I know are up there. So, and it is immensely frustrating. There is an awful lot. There were something like 450 to 500 Antares articles, which you may not be aware of. We know that because we exported them all and loaded them up onto a new website, and I have been going through editing all of them, getting rid of some which are just newsletters, getting rid of others which are just saying, oh, product announcement, or the next one which says, do you remember that product announcement? Here it is! You know, or and the next one afterwards which said, you know that product was released, don't forget it's there. And so some of those are just merging those sort of articles together. But nonetheless, there's still been about 450 articles which I've had to go through to actually distill them down into something that's sensible. And what we've done is something which I think a lot of people have been asking for, is put them into the Nexus. The Antares Nexus is a website. It's fundamentally a information site, and it's going to be that core, in other words, the Nexus through which everything runs, of Antares. So this is where all these new scenarios will come, all the new material will actually go straight into there. We'll see the news and the newsletters going into the Nexus as well, so you have the news feed in there as well. And we're also going to have a community side of that as well. So if people create stuff, they can actually submit it to us, and the idea is that we're going to have a number of sub-editors who can say, fine, that can actually go into, if you like, the core, the canon. I hate using the word canon because it's not quite that rich, because personally I think Antares is so wide that there's an awful lot of things which can exist within those 5 or 6 million star systems that is currently connected to Antares. So there's some stuff which we'd like to have and actually make smart enough and actually say, yeah, we can take this, we can do something with this. But there's also a whole load of, as I said earlier, fan-created stuff which is going to be interesting to an awful lot of gamers. Which, for whatever reason, we, you know, as well, won't be able to do anything with. But nonetheless, it's worth having up in something like the Nexus to say, no, look, you know, try it. Look at it, try it for yourself, see what it looks like. So, the question is then, obviously, what is the Nexus? Now, most wargamers do historical wargames as well as everything else. But when we want to do something like historical wargames, we go to books, or we go to the web, and most of us just sort of click on quite quickly onto Wiki and then perhaps follow the links from Wikipedia. We've already bookmarked a number of specialist sites who we could go for historical information. I know I have. But there is nothing like that on Antares. So what we need is a repository of all those articles and an area where you can actually go. And that's what the Nexus is going to be. It's called the Nexus, obviously it's the hub, it's the thing, the core of Antares, so you can go there for everything. Which is, it's actually everything you wanted to know about Antares is where it's supposed to be. I've got some screenshots coming up of the development system, the system we're currently putting together. So, and there are bits of it which we know are subject to change, so don't hold me to anything which comes up here. But this is what the homepage is at the moment on a normal everyday PC. Bounded by this sort of black border. So as you can see at the top, Antares Nexus. Don't know, so you know where you are. Home you've got five main headings there: home, news, rural, central, game resources, and community, which is what I was just been saying earlier. So game resources is almost everything to do with the game, in terms of how we play the game, descriptions of units, how to paint, and that sort of stuff. Community is these community resources that I was going to talk about, and we actually have some other community things going on as well. The front screen, the idea is, and how quickly we'll get this done, we don't know. But the idea is you can almost tailor the front screen to how you want. So for example, by default, as soon as you come in, you'll get the Getting Started button and the latest set of articles for Getting Started. Sticky is the PDF Army Lists, because everybody needs the PDF Army Lists. So once you've got over Getting Started stuff and you don't want it, you can just click on it, see there's an X up there, and get rid of it, and you'll get rid of that tile set. Next thing coming up is Showcase, which is one of the things we wanted up there. It's got all the cool minis. As you can see, we've got the latest, there's no use for this, I'm bouncing on one leg. We've got Wayne Clayton's How to Build His Spaceship article, which I mentioned earlier. We've got Ian Ackerman's Arsorians. He used these wonderful new nano shields for his shield drones, which I thought was really lovely. Totally non-standard, but nonetheless, I thought they were so good that it's worth coming up. And they arouse quite a lot of interest in the studio as well. So as you can see, that the community, you guys, the players, can actually start influencing the way the studio thinks as well, which I think is really good, really important. And then we've got Rocky's War Room, which I think he came out this week, is that right? He had a series of articles on assembling all the models. And he did a fast-forward assembly of the Boromite Broodmother, for example, which I thought was absolutely brilliant. So you don't sit there watching somebody do it, you can actually see them. Then he stops at the end and says, the problems I had with this were, and he explains, and he says, don't do what I did, you know, 5 frames ago, which I think is absolutely wonderful. This side banner will also be able to be dropped out, so you can actually just access everything from the top if you wanted to. But this goes on down with a whole set of different category settings. The factions, I already know that this is going to change, so that's going to be another drop-down of these. So if you click on background at the moment, what you'll get is the top three, the first three background, latest background articles, so you can always see the latest stuff. And then there's another button underneath it which says, show me all the background articles. So you can start hunting through by background. Or you can start hunting through by community submitted stuff, or fiction, or gaming and collecting, or background, or something else. So that's all the categories. I'll come on to the next one. And of course, latest news. We've got the connected thing at the top, which is currently just who's actually connected to the Nexus, as you can tell. I think that was just me and I don't know who that avatar that is. I think that's probably Richard Coates, who's our web designer. And then that goes on down the bottom. So once again, the PDF Army Lists are stickied, and these are all the latest scenarios, or not scenarios, I should say. They're the latest articles which have actually gone up onto the site. Just happens that they've come up in this order because I've been going through creating new articles and editing them and pulling that stuff together. So I've only got about 100, I've got less than 100 to go with that, which is really, really good. I think it's really good because that's 30 articles in colours. But as you can see, what we've got is the scenario competition. Lee Davidson sent in a scenario for the scenario competition. And we're starting to publish those now. I'm starting to pull them together, load them up onto here, and there's another one which you can't see there yet, but because it's still in draft, I wasn't able to get it up in time. But all of those will be up there as well. Obviously, Bromvar will be coming out in PDF as well. We've got introduction. So the Zalus Horizon article isn't that salesy article which you get sometimes in the newsletter, but it actually says this is what you get in Horizon, this is what you can do with it. Community Showcase over there, which is the Rocky's War Room one, which came up recently. And then you've got everything on all the rest. So, a Getting Started article on unit model stats, what to do with it. The Boromite Matriarch actually goes into the Matriarch stats. It breaks down what weapons she's got, and it breaks down, it gives you a little bit of tactical advice on how to use her. And we've done that for every single unit in the game. that we've actually got released at the moment, so you won't find it for the big M50s or the C3M Drupal's in Moments, etc. But for every other unit in the game, there is this article which says, this is how you use it, this is what it looks like. So as you can see, that's some of them there. And as you can see, I've just panned over to show this. We've also got standard tag cloud as well, which you see on a lot of WordPress or blog sites. So in addition to actually categorizing everything, we've also linked in a whole bunch of tags for everything. So you can actually click on tags to help you get a far more specific search criteria. And obviously, I don't know if you saw at the top, but there is the old skimtail box right at the top. So there's the generalized search function. But hopefully by having these multiple different ways of getting to the data, it's going to make it easier for everybody to get to what's there. Rule Central. You know that blob at the top? Yeah, we're going to be linking to Rule Central from almost everywhere. And this is what it is. I don't know if you've tried to find an old PDF, it's a recurring question on the Facebook page, isn't it? Where is the rules of the RATA? It's here. Everything's going to be linked through from this, the Rule Central. There'll be something else coming up here because we are releasing a online version of the rules. It's a slightly cut down version of the rules, but it has got, I think the only thing it's not got in it is some more detailed rules such as reactions and what's it's not got? A couple of details and assaults, I believe. But that is it. It's effectively got huge amounts of rules in it, and it's got some of the core units in it as well, with the unit stats and the weapon stats. And that will be here. So every time we actually update anything, it will be on Rule Central. So there's no where is, do you know where is, it's here. Living errata and living fact will be maintained on here as well, rather than spread around. And this is, for example, one of the scenarios. So Lee effectively just sent us a rough and ready diagram. So we'll make it into the diagram, see the bullet. We'll put the graphics on it and we'll copy it in and make sure it's actually in the format we know. And there will be for everybody to see. So it's a case of do be part of this. We'd love to see you guys submit stuff for the Nexus. This is just a few things about hints and tips. Before I go on to it, are there any questions at the moment?
So, it's two actually. How do you control what goes on the tiles and how you submit stuff? So,
you'd submit stuff to us,
right,
or to an editor, and then we'd load it up. In terms of what goes into the tiles, we will give it a title, and we will give it an image as necessary, hopefully from the images you send us. So, for example, I don't know if I can go backwards, can I go backwards? So for example, the 66th Nomad, you can see at the top.
Yeah.
See Ian Ackerman's up here. The image from that was actually from the images he sent in as part of his themed force, the 66th.
Yeah.
So that's what we'll do. So it's not free for all, just dump it up. And we can't frankly do it with like a free for all sort of situation because this is stuff which we are in effect publishing or enabling to be published. So
Because you obviously were aware of units and how you use them, so having that bit of the link as a commentary kind of thing could fit into that. Comments will remain as always. The other question was, you put in one for every unit, does that include special characters? Yeah. So that also leads to why the bullet infection.
But in the supplement, what you actually get is all the scenarios. What you'll get is the actual characters themselves and the full details. And there will not be space on here to actually have all the details of every single character or every single squad. So you'll still need to get to the books for the full details about individual weapons and individual rules, which we're not going to, we just can't repeat every single rule everywhere it's referenced.
I saw some unit cards upstairs in the hall that are from Atari Genius. Yes. Is that the kind of thing that's going to be on the website?
Yes, if he wants these to come here, we'll load them up and just say, here we go, there are some unit cards. The only trouble with unit cards and that sort of stuff, of course, they can go out of date, which is why I didn't update my unit cards, because of the fact that we then had a few rule changes and we then had version 2 where the points changed. But we'll have them up, and it's a case of a caveat of this is fan submitted stuff. Use it, find it, but be aware that it's not cool. Certainly not cool supported stuff. I tend to have little printed out sheets which I update each time. It's once you've created one. So I exported it from Battlescribe and then altered it with all my own data. So when you're writing for Antares, it's a case of thinking Antares, and this is where we're getting more into the sort of like how to think about writing, if you like. It's a hard space opera universe. It's not a gothic, it's not a grungy, it's not a cyberpunk sort of universe. So it's not worth thinking about in those words. In places, though, it will have that sort of stuff. There's nothing wrong with having a particular subset who is more cyberpunky in approach. They're a little bit behind the times in Concord or Asurian Intel worlds, and they're only just coming up. So maybe they're going through the cyberpunk phase where they're mix and matching the intelligences that they've now got access to with their previous culture. And it may be that there is also places where there is a Gothic style of architecture. But in the whole, what we're saying is just think in the way of Antares. Each faction's got its own particular approach. It's got its own particular feel of its army. So just think about that when you're working there. But the key thing is why I've said that there will be exceptions, and we can certainly look at great exceptions, is that there are over 5.5 million systems linked to the Antares Nexus. Last time we calculated it based on the Star Travel data. And that's an awful lot of systems. As I said, there's going to be huge amounts of diversity. It's because of the sheer number of systems that you get this separation of Concord into sub-shards. So you get different shards. The Concord says we are one, but actually it takes months, maybe years, to get from one side of the Nexus in the Concord to the other side of the Nexus. So whilst every system is being updated, it's a bit like the fourth bridge. By the time you get to that end, the update's being propagated again from the other side. But also the updates picked up from this end are being propagated back through the other systems. So there's going to be a huge amount of diversity, and it's because of that that you get this subshell of Concord and other intel societies. I've said already, factions have distinct personalities, and it's probably worth just mentioning them quickly. Boromites are the workers. They're only warriors in need when they absolutely have to be. They're fighting against another clan, or they're defending a particular claim. If they think it's something that's theirs, and you are violating that. Yeah, they're possessive, it's understandable. They are about extracting what they can from what's available as a finite resource. And that's something to think about. They're there to work as well, and if you upset their work, it means you're upsetting their livelihood. Important stuff. The Intel's quite protective for getting the Concord and Senatex fight. But even though it can seem to be coherent, it's got variants within it. And we might, we'll see some of that background, for example, coming out in the Gromblast supplement when it comes out. It's going to be a PDF edit. And you'll see a different shard, Concord shard in there. And again, that's player based. That's a shard called Blue 519. It's separate from the rest of the Concord. When it was finished integrating, it had its own nanosphere. And it ended up, when it integrated, they found that the balance of its own nanosphere to the proper Concord nanosphere, to be isolated, was 519 parts per thousand. Hence, Blue 519. you've thinking about the guard, they're combative, but they're a bit limited. There's only a few of them who've got any imagination. Freeborn, fundamental opportunistic traders, but they can be involved in all sorts of skullduggery. So do run with it. So that's the sort of like a really quick brief of the background, but it's also a case of imagining where. This is the Antarian space, as you all know from the Cool World book, and this is actually up on the, this is one of the articles up on the Nexus, so it's easy to get to. But you've got a real heavy concentration of star systems along the equator, the tropics of Oberon, and then you get less and less and less as you actually go up towards the poles. But as you can see, the Concorde, the Arsurian Shard maybe take up about a third, probably actually only a quarter, frankly. The vault space, we still don't fully know exactly where it is, but there are all these different gaps in the whole Nexus, which is where star systems, rifts they're called, it's where star systems are too far apart, or they're too deep and they're too difficult to get to, or there for some reason there's a little gap in the actual gates, so it's difficult to get to these individuals. And you've got particular areas like the Eastern Interface up there is quite heavily separated from some of the rest. It's almost like an isolated area of its own. And there's no reason, given that this is, we're looking at 258 astronomical units here, there's no reason why you can't have smaller areas where you set up your own little campaign or group of systems, which could comprise maybe as, you know, 50-100 worlds, though it's going to be difficult to detail that many worlds. They're not going to impact on 3.5 million. So there's a huge amount of flexibility there. So thinking it within the Antares scope, you've still got huge amounts of flexibility to go somewhere. And the other thing to think about is that, hence the map, it's a long way. It can take months across gates and the entire surface. There's a time dilation factor of about 11 to 1. So what to you seems to be a day will be 11 days. Going elsewhere, that's one of the oddities of the Antares machine. And then you can actually spend hours to weeks inside a gate, travelling from Antares to a gate in a system, in your own little bubble. And then it can normally takes an average about 2 days to get from a gate to a world. And all of this will help you frame where interactions are going to take place. But because the actual distance depends on the output of a star. So if it's a really hot, intense, quite big star, it's huge amounts of output, radiation output, the gate will be further away. But if it's a smaller star, so you've got some of the dwarfs, the F star, the F class dwarfs, I think, the blue dwarfs, the gate is much, much closer. So travel is going to be much shorter. But this means that where you position everything is dependent, really is dependent on that axis. Travel depends on the ship. So Arsurians are fast, very, very fast, as you'd expect. Gar are, well, frankly, very, very slow. The Arsurians, I think, have got an acceleration of somewhere around about 150g of the smaller ships. The Gar, but they're lucky if their fast scan ships can get 50g. But there's also limits on how fast ships can go, because when they're in system, they've got to have shielding against all the rubbish actually in that system. But all of this, the reason why I'm mentioning it, sounds a little bit abstract, but it actually impacts on where spaceships interact, because when you're moving at a tenth of the speed of light, it's very difficult to interact with somebody else moving at a tenth of the speed of light. So you tend to find that ships interact where they come out of the gate, because they're moving relatively slowly before they accelerate up, and at a destination, at a planet, at an asteroid, at a star system, which I think makes a really solid justification for the way Antares works. But that affects how you want to write it. Does that make sense? And characters, just a quick advice, you'd expect this. Only use main characters in passing. Use easily translatable ranks. The ranks we've only really identified here, obviously. Captain, commander, general. You should only use some ranks specific for your enemies. For example, I've used Decurion as a senior NCO rank in for my Freeborn. But then I use Sergeant, I think, for a slightly lesser one. But that's just my Freeborn. You are free to use your own for your own Concord shot or for your own Freeborn house, for example. I also have to use naval ranks, but then I come from a naval background, and you use naval ranks as well. So there we go. Names. Oh, one thing. Oh, names. Please don't use this as an apostrophe unless you absolutely have to. Mean to use it. Does anyone know what glottal stop is? It's when you say water, which is the word you should normally say. The glottal stop is when you drop the T and just go water. So it's that sound. That's really well, a really good use of an apostrophe. I know SF has got a tendency to use it, but if I saw about a pound for every apostrophe I saw about a scene, I'd be over rich. The whole point about Antarian names and the way it has to be presented across this huge disparity of languages, cultures, and everything else is effectively that the names are set as they're written. So we've got a mercenary bounty hunter coming out soon who comes from a race called the Hurk. Or I should probably say Hurk. I think this is how Rick prefers it. And it's just spelled like that. Straightforward, Hurk. Nothing else in it, so it's written as it's said. You should try and avoid current names as well. Some things will sound quite similar, you know that you can't affect, can't have that. But try and avoid them. If you can, so no Fred blogs. Though I dare say there is a guard probably called Fred because his four-digit nomenclature is called FRED, and that's just bad luck for him. Or good luck for us. So the summary: it's fundamentally what I said up front. We're looking for. We'd love to see some great ideas, scenarios, campaigns. Obviously, we'd love to see them come up. Whether it ends up being on the fan side, whether it actually is something that we actually say, no, it needs to be pushed up a little more. Background, exactly the same. Theme selectors, forces, those will be more likely to actually come in as core lists. Especially the tactical advice and how to beat sort of articles. Good fiction. I expect to see an awful lot of fiction on the community side as well. But then I also expect to see an awful lot of background and theme selectors, of course, on the community side. So in other words, it's where people's imagination goes absolutely crazy. We'd love to pull some in and actually say to people, look, there's more, there's all of this lot. So, and that would just go out in the newsletter as well to say, look, something you were showing in really, really great if you like to showcase it. And obviously, as ever, we are a war games company, so you'd expect it. But frankly, I love making terrain. I love to see people having hints and tips on what terrain is, how to make a particular type of terrain, how to run this spaceship. I've mentioned it three or four times, but I did love it. And I did love another set of terrain upstairs in a dome. I just love that sort of stuff. It's really great. However, the point is, I don't think we've got any other seminars afterwards, so it's a case of, if you've got any questions, we can go on as long as you want. But do you mind if I sit down and just report certain? Is that okay?
I've been doing a lot of video for this.
Yep.
Are you guys after video content? But it would be the sort of hobby stuff.
Yes, certainly are. That would be fantastic. You saw up there, that was Rocky's War Room, and he did the video of Borrowers, and that's just something we've had out this week, and we'd love to be able to say on the community button on the right, saying, look, these are video channels, games video channels, go for them, and we'd have an article on yours, or we'd help you write an article for us, and we'd just say, there it is. So Rocky Ball Room Index, and say, go for it. That would be absolutely fantastic. That's anybody else, or do I say too much? It's a
What was it? Are you a warlord running the next Open Signal? Is that an independent? It's always a call out for stories.
Open Signal? Oh no, that's, they run that almost completely independently of Warlord. Rick will be does have a look at the background to it. He's had a very light touch recently, but he may end up having a stronger interaction with it as the story's developing, and you have to have that sort of oversight because the stories start interacting in different ways. You have to start saying, well, actually, that can't happen because they weren't going to do that, or actually, this is just about coming up which the writer could not have known about at all, and that will affect the way things could happen. So, no, Rick looks after the actual fiction side of stuff in terms of keeping it on the Antares track of its own.
So things like a vault might be something that you don't touch for a while.
You don't touch that. Yeah, we've already had to say to somebody, unfortunately, no, you can't have this vault story. You can't do any more with this vault story other than stop when the person gets killed or shot by the vault. Which is really unfortunate, but the vault just aren't developed enough to do that.
We've got no idea what they look like. We don't know how the culture of the military works. It's going to be stuff that will be out next year or speaking the year after.
Yeah, Rick and I, frankly, are hoping it will be towards the tail end of next year, but we just don't know. Is it because they're the way they're being put together? I've seen some concepts of what they're going to be like, but we don't. That's a 3D print, and how that translates into a plastic mould. It's going to be very, very different, and we've got to be really careful with plastic molds. I think Rick mentioned it earlier. We had a quote for something which we were going to do for one of the vehicles. When just producing the mold was something all of a sudden twice the price of the previous molds, and it's expensive enough producing molds from plastic. So it's quite. We've got to make sure that they're right rather than get them out.
So yeah, because it's an enormous upfront cost.
Yeah, it is. And Warlords, Warlords growing really well. But it's making that transition between states, I think, between small and really big. But that's pretty my intention, that's not official Warlords state. I swear, I have to give that out of that. The caveat of that. So.
Yeah, certainly I've noticed that Warlords are more than plastics, and Antares is now in a state where you've got four armies with what are almost entirely plastic starters that are retail for 50 quid each. You've got the 35 quid starter, you've got the 70 quid starter, you're now going to have the portals online, or the army lists online. It's looking at reducing the barriers to people picking it up.
Absolutely. I couldn't agree more. And that's what we've got to do. I think we've got to do something like this, where it's not just making sure we've got things like World Central and so on. Everything's here. Yes, we update things because we're trying to communicate the updates. I think Rick said earlier, in the old days, it was a case of you writing away to the author of a rule set and closing your SAE, and he'd send you back the errata. Nowadays, we've got a web, and I think we have to do it all online to say, these are the updates, and just take them, download them.
Yeah.
The rules, there's cut down version of the rules when I was one of the proofreaders for that, and I struggled to see where they were cut down. You had to know the rules to know where they were cut down. And yes, after a while you think, oh, so you've done, so you cut out here, but they're correct.
Yeah. So somebody can pick up a couple of boxes of miniatures from somewhere and then start having a go.
With that PDF? Yeah, absolutely.